The creature didn't notice Forn, but she could see that it was an outline of a cat creature. She had can see the outline because of the light was flickering in the hallway that illuminated the area. Forn had her pistol in her hands, and she was about ready to shoot down the creature. As it turned to see Forn, it had eyes of a cat with fur covering its body. It was the ferry driver from Moonscar Island. The cat creature stared at Forn before it made a hissing sound, followed by a loud cat shriek. Mystery Inc. woke up, feeling startled when they heard the shriek of a cat. Daphne, Fred, Velma, Shaggy, and Scooby woke up, wondering what the hell was that sound. What the hell was that? Daphne groaned as they heard more shrieks, followed by gunshots. We better go see what's going on, gang, Fred said, as he armed himself with a shotgun. Someone might be injured, Velma added. As the gang all ran out of the bathroom, they all saw Forn with a gun in her hands. She was caked in dry blood, and the cat creature's lifeless body was on the floor.
Zoinks! Like, what the hell happened?
Shaggy shrieked. There was a scream out there, so I went out to see who was screaming. When I saw this cat creature in the hallway, it then attacked me, Forn explained, while shaking in fear. I shot him multiple times. Fred and Daphne moved the body onto its back. It was the ferry driver from Moonscar Island. The gang were surprised. Jacques had been shot multiple times on his chest. Bullet holes surrounded the cat creature's chest. Most of them were bleeding. Why are you caked in blood? Daphne asked as Forn revealed her arm. The wound that was opened back up from when the zombie attacked her back at the last mission. He tried to attack me, and when he did, he messed up my arm, Forn replied, starting to feel drowsiness from losing blood. Oh god, Forn's losing so much blood, Fred said, as he grabbed the rags to stop the bleeding. Dog! Velma called, seeing Dog race into the hallway. Forn's losing too much blood, her wound opened back up again. Velma led Dog to the crime scene that the cat creature's lifeless body had been dead for less than an hour. My arm's bleeding again. God, I think I got my artery. Forn cut short when she passed out. The cat creature must have opened the stitches again, Dog cursed as two doctors and a few nurses walked in. Is Forn okay? Shaggy asked. She's not dead. She's just passed out from losing a lot of blood, Dog replied, as the doctors brought in a stretcher and the nurses took a look at her open wound. You sure have good doctors here, Daphne said, seeing Forn being taken to the emergency room. We've seen worse before. I was shot by a group of raiders that tried to raid our stockade 3 weeks ago, Dog replied. If it wasn't for my son, I wouldn't have been here right now. I hope Forn will survive. We've been through much worse, Velma sighed. A few hours later, Forn woke up in a lit-up room. Her eyes were hurting as they were adjusting to where she was. She slowly looked around. She could see a heart monitor attached to her. She looked at the arm where the wound was, and it was bandaged up properly. She had even a blood pack attached to the arm that she had the wound on. Forn was freaking out on the inside, but remained calm on the outside. On her arm, where there were no injuries, had attached to it was an IV bag. Forn wasn't sure on what happened or where she was. She's been blacked out for a couple of hours at most. So she turned to see Daphne on the chair, scrolling on her phone. When Daphne looked up, she could see that Forn was awake. You're awake! We were really scared back there, Daphne said, happy that Forn was awake. What happened? My eyes hurt, my arm hurts, my head hurts. Everything hurts, Forn said, as her eyes slowly finally adjusted to her surroundings, even in the light. You were passed out from blood loss. That cat creature that attacked you, he reopened your wound that you got, Daphne explained. You lost a lot of blood, but you're very lucky to be alive. Oh, that's what happened. Sorry about that, Daph. I've been out for a while. I don't remember what happened before I was out, Forn replied. Dog's doctors attached the IV bag to you and a blood pack. They want to make sure that you're hydrated as well as replace the blood you lost, Daphne said. As Forn sat up, she could feel the pain in her body, but she ignored it. My wound opened back up when that cat creature attacked, and I lost a lot of blood, Thorn replied. Dog said that the doctors restitched your wound back up, and to make sure it didn't get infected. That's why they wrapped your arm up, Daphne said. At least you're okay. I'll let the others know. Just then Luna and Dusk showed up. Thorn, we're so glad you're awake, Dusk said, as she and Luna gave Thorn a hug. The doctors say that you're going to be okay, with some rest at least, Luna added. I feel shit like shit right now, girls. My body aches so much, Thorn groaned in reply. Yeah, you got attacked by the cat creature, Dusk said. Dog says you'll be fine with some rest. And you're going to be stay put today, and we don't want you to get even more hurt or worse, Luna added. As the pregnant woman walked in, it was Jody. She was the same girl that the Hex girls, Shaggy and Scooby and Ox, found on the streets. Jody, you're a nurse? Thorn asked, sounding surprised. Why, yes, I am. I was a nurse before the outbreak, Jody began. I just got into maternity leave, and that's when it all started. And I was in a group of survivors when it started. Well, that sounds rough, Daphne replied. Where was your husband or boyfriend when this started? Well, he sadly died. Jody began to tear up. He helped me get away with the group of survivors, and that's when the zombies were surrounding my house. I got lucky and got away with my group, and my husband, he didn't make it. I'm sorry. I'm sure he would have wanted you to have this child, Thorn said, giving Jody her support. He would have been an awesome dad. I sometimes wonder what kind of dad he would have been if he was alive, Jody replied. Anyways, I've come here to make sure you're okay. Mr. Ink and Dog told me what happened. I was asleep when the whole screaming and yelling and fighting was happening. I'm okay, but everything I feel hurts, Thorn said as she groaned in pain. Dog explained to me what happened. You're very lucky to be alive, Jody replied, while taking notes. I'll be good as soon as I'm better. I have no symptoms of blood being restored in my system, Thorn said. Oh, okay. That's mainly why Dog wants to make sure that you're not having any symptoms of blood poisoning, Jody replied. I'll let Dog know that how you feel. Doctors might want to change your bandages on your arm. I understand. I'm glad the cut I got had been restitched, Thorn groaned as she was leaning on her arm a bit. Try not to lean on your arm too much. We don't want to have the stitches to become undone again, Jody said. So, besides some pain, is everything fine? Yes, Jody, everything's good, Thorn replied. Just as Jody left the room, Luna placed a hand on Thorn's shoulder, knowing the shit that everyone had been going through. They know that the zombie outbreak will end eventually. However, it will take some time for help to arrive. We survived the outbreak so far, and we'll all get through this, Luna reassured her friend. Dog wants you to rest today. Means no missions, as you're taking today to recover. Okay, that's what I'll do, Thorn replied. Just then Lunar came in and armed up and ready to go. Luna, Dog wants us to track down where the two other cat creatures were, Lunar said. Did he manage to track them down? Lunar asked, turning his attention to Lunar, then nodded. I have a mission to do now, Thorn. Just rest up and not leave this room. I won't. You two go ahead, Thorn replied. She then laid back down on the hospital bed. In the next room, Daphne walked to see Fred and Velma, looking at some photos and files on the table. She walked up to them and she looked at the photos and files as well. Hey, Daph, how's Sally doing? Fred asked. She's okay. She's not going to be going anywhere for a while, Daphne replied. So what's going on? Dog was able to locate Max and Steve and Laura's hideouts. In this part of Fairview, Velma pointed at the building that looked like a hideout. This hideout is also known as Cyronicum Bunker. Rumors say that there's doctors and scientists there. Whoa, that looks like all the way on the other side of Fairview, Daphne said in surprise. Indeed, we'll need a vehicle to get there. Once we're all ready, we'll stop the cat creatures, Fred stated. The first one that Thorn killed last night was Jacques, the ferry driver from Moonscar Island. So Simone and Lena are still alive, said Velma. Lunar and I are going to go do a mission. Dogs orders you guys to take any few army men with you to get supplies, Luna said to Fred and his friends. We better get moving, Velma said, as she, Fred, and Daphne got ready to go on a supply hunt. An hour had gone by, and Luna and Lunar were walking down the streets of Fairview. Not knowing where they were, they had to look for some ammo and weapons that could be useful. They came across a woman with two heads, and she didn't seem to notice them as she was in the distance. "What is that?" Luna asked. "That is a siren. If she notices us, she will alert the horde and we'll have to fall back," Lunar replied. He aimed his sniper rifle at the zombie with two heads. He held his breath and took a shot at it. Once he took the shot, the zombie dropped dead to the floor. "Nice one, that was a headshot," Luna complimented. "I could teach you that sometime if you like. Like at combat practice, we can," Lunar replied, as he winked at Luna. As the two walked into the junkyard, they saw a huge zombie with spikes on its arm. "That's a bone. You and your friends hit one of them on your way here." "Yeah, and he sure scared the shit out of us," Luna replied, as she took her hunting rifle and shot at the bone in the head. He just dropped dead like the siren did. Just as Luna and Lunar approached a house in the junkyard, they bypassed some zombies that had not noticed them walking into the junkyard. As soon as they were inside, Luna and Lunar looked around for some supplies. They found a machine gun in a chest near to a bed. Lunar was surprised. "Holy shit, we found the ultimate weapon," Lunar said, as Luna showed up beside Lunar. "Oh my, this is a badass machine gun," Luna replied. "What it's called?" "It's called a GUA-19, a legendary rare weapon. Dog has many of those. He's planning on giving them to you guys since you guys are going to stop the cat creatures and those scientists at Mystery Inc. dealt with them in Scorpion Ridge years ago," Lunar replied. "Aid. Those weapons will work great against the infected," Luna said. "Yeah, we have a lot of engineers working on making more weapons," Lunar replied. When the two walked out of the house, they saw a siren in the distance had noticed them. She let out a loud scream, alerting the infected and even the mutated ones. "Shit, run," Luna instructed, as she and Lunar ran as fast as they could out of the junkyard. As soon as they got out of the junkyard, there was a huge bloated zombie showed up between and left the two. But of course they looked to the left to see the bloated zombie, one big and one medium. "Bloats. They'll explode when you kill them. So I advise you stay out of their way when you kill them," Lunar advised. Then he and Luna ran down the road all the way and they came back to Dog's stockade. When they approached the entrance of the stockade, Dog was out there with his guards. They saw that Luna and Lunar were approaching the entrance. Once again, they had to show Dog and his guards proof that they were not bitten before they were allowed back inside the stockade. When they entered the safe area, Luna and Lunar showed the machine guns that they had found in the junkyard. "Excellent, you two. Mystery Inc. are doing their chores for their duties. Daphne and Fred, along with Velma, returned not too long ago, and Foreign is doing fine now." "That's great to hear. Where's Rose?" Luna asked. "She said that she and some of our police officers headed out to Prenek 13. They're on the radio with us, and they said that maybe Chief Jackson can help you guys," Dog said, as they walked inside the stockade towards the medical unit to see Foreign exit out. "She's free to go, girls," says the doctors, "but would recommend that she keep the stiff arm wrapped up to avoid any infections or having the wound open up again," one of the nurses said. "That's great news to hear. How are you doing, Sally?" Luna asked. "I'm doing okay. My body was hurting from earlier, but they're not hurting as much. Jody gave me some painkillers to take," Luna Foreign replied. "Jody is the pregnant nurse, right?" Lunar asked Foreign a question, which Foreign replied with a nod. "Jody can have the baby any day now, Dog. We have some supplies here, but we would need to get more just in case," Velma said, as she with Mystery Inc. approached the leader, Luna and Lunar. "We have to get those medical supplies. We do have some, but they're not the best equipment to deliver a baby," Dusk said. "Well, I can go and get them at the hospital a few blocks down," Foreign volunteered. "Are you sure about that, Foreign? But what about your arm?" Daphne asked. "The nurses said that I'll be okay. Even Jody says that as well. As long as I keep the stitches wrapped up, no infection will worsen it, and the stitches won't open back up," Thorn reassured her friend. If you say so, me and Daphne will go with you, Velma stated to Thorn. For extra hands, I'll go too, Dusk added, as she handed Thorn a shotgun. Where did you get this shotgun? Thorn asked. I found it at the junkyard at the part of the stockade. I tested it out and it's more powerful than the one used in Nesta's hideout, Dusk replied. I'll take it. So where's the nearest hospital? Thorn asked. The nearest hospital is about a few blocks to the right. Be careful, though, Dog stated. I heard that there is a mother near the hospital. Is that another type of infected? Velma asked. Yes, it is. And she has four arms and has a swollen stomach with a mouth with an eye on it. Dusk, you better be careful. And same with you, Velma, Dog stated. Sounds like that she was infected while pregnant. We'll have to be on the lookout for her, Thorn replied. Yes, so be careful out there. We'll alert you if anything happens with Jody, Lunar said, as Thorn nodded. Then Thorn, Daphne, Dusk, and Velma exited out of the stockade and headed towards right for the hospital. On their way there, they encountered some zombies, which they had managed to kill most of them without making any sound to attract the others. They approached the hospital front doors, and as Velma looked inside to make sure that there was no one inside, upon looking up inside the hospital, the coast was clear. Coast is clear, girls. Maternity ward is on the third floor, Velma said, as she slowly pushed the door open to let herself, Dusk, Thorn, and Daphne inside. They all snuck inside the hospital without alerting any zombies. Once inside the hospital, they started to look around for clues. They had headed for the elevator that could take them to all floors of the hospital. The only problem when they got to the elevator was that there was no power in the building. Power's out. We'll have to take the stairs to the third floor. When we get there, we'll grab anything that could be useful for delivering a baby, Thorn stated, as she, Dusk, Velma, and even Daphne headed upstairs. Until they reached the third floor. Once they were on the third floor, they walked down the hallway to find a storage area with supplies. The supplies have to be here somewhere. Where can we look? Dusk asked. Then Thorn looked to see a shadowy figure standing in front of the door for a while, about 15 feet away from them. The girls pulled out their weapons and slowly approached the figure. Hold it right there. We're not here and we're not going to hurt you, but please speak up if you're infected or not, Velma ordered. The figure stopped and standing in the front door. Then it turned its head to the girls. I recognize who you are. You're Velma from Mystery Inc., said the familiar voice. It revealed to be Steve as soon as he stepped in the reach of the flashlight. Steve, you're one of the scientists that we had you arrested during the alien shenanigans, Velma stated in surprise. You're right on that. Laura and Max and I escaped the prison when the zombies started to roam Fairview. You, Steve replied. I know who the Hex Girls are. You're with Dog and his stockade. How did you know about that? Daphne asked. I have been spying on you guys ever since you showed up in Nesta's hideout. We brought back the cat creatures before the mysterious virus broke out, turning the dead into living into mutated zombies, Steve answered. We also used a book on the frontier of the dead. We used it to bring the cat creatures to life. However, there are rumors that with that book that has somehow mysteriously brought out the virus as well. So that book has turned the living into flesh-eating zombies. Dog knew is you guys. We have proof at his stockade for yourself, Velma taunted. Oh, I'm so scared. Not that I give a rat's ass about it. What brings you on this floor? Is Daphne pregnant? Steve asked. Daphne's expression turned from calm and collected to pure rage. Take that back, what you said. I'm not pregnant, Daphne snapped. This is an insult to me, especially to a woman who is not pregnant. Yeah, you can't talk like that to Daphne, you piece of crap. Come here where I could pummel your ass down. Dusk taunted as Steve ran towards Dusk before her and Thorn pummeled him to the ground. As Steve was struggling to get up from under Dusk and Thorn's weights, Thorn noticed a bite mark on Steve's arm. He was bitten. Holy shit, Steve's been bitten, Vorn said. I knew he could have been bitten by one of them. He could turn into a zombie at any moment now. Dusk and Vorn were soon thrown off as Steve, who began to vomit blood and some radiation acid. The girls watched helplessly as Steve transformed into an irradiated zombie. It looked like the girls and snarled. Oh my god, he's been bitten. That's how he transformed, Daphne said in shock. And mutated as well. We saw him coughed up acid and blood, Velma added, as Vorn and Dusk grabbed their weapons to fight off the now zombified Steve. We'll fight him off. Get to the door to the storage area and open, Vorn instructed, as Velma and Daphne did what they could to get to open the storage room door. While that was going on, the zombified Steve started to fight Vorn and Dusk. As Vorn ran around to find a weapon, Steve vomited towards Dusk's direction as she jumped out of the way within a second. Vorn grabbed a machete that she could find, and once she got behind the zombified Steve, she hit him in the head, which followed by the machete hitting his skull. There was a cracking sound as the zombified Steve fell dead to the floor. Holy shit, that was too close, Dusk said as she got up from jumping out of the way from the radiation vomit. Yeah, he transformed into one of those irradiated zombies that vomit acid, Vorn replied as she heard the click of the storage room unlocking. We got the door open, just in time too. I wasn't sure how much longer we could be, Daphne said. Then the girls head inside the maternity storage room. Upon entering inside, Velma grabbed her backpack, and she and her friends grabbed the supplies. They stuffed the backpack with us as much supplies as they could. Once they packed as much as they could, the backpack was full. You think this is going to be enough? Daphne asked. I'm sure it will be enough. I do know dogs got medical stuff. Extra of these may come in handy, Velma replied. She does have a point. I think we're good here, Dusk stated. Yeah, let's get out of here, or we may alert a horde somewhere in this hospital, Vorn added, when the girls headed down the stairs and out of the hospital through the front doors. Once they walked out of the hospital, they started to walk down the dead, quiet street. There's something about Luna and Lunar. I have noticed that they have been together for a few days. Like, I noticed that they were talking more. I think they like each other, Vorn said. I think so, too. I secretly believe that Luna loves him, Daphne replied. Me and Dusk would tease Luna about, her liking a guy, and that was back during the Oak Cave and Autumn Fest. Last time we did, she made us play a drinking game with alcohol. Vorn cackled a laugh. Oh, damn. She must have got you guys wasted, Daphne chuckled back. Yeah, we did. And with Steve dead and over with, I think there's a way to end the living dead and the cat creatures. Like having the world go back to normal, Vorn said. Where the hell did you learn about that? Daphne asked. Before Steve mutated into one of the infected, he said something about a spell book of some kind. I don't think Dog mentioned it or anything, but I do think the book can break the spell, Vorn replied. How will a book break a spell? It's not like an Evil Dead movie or anything. How good will that do? Daphne questioned. Well, the book is called The Frontier of the Dead. Steve, along with Max and Laura, used it to bring the cat's creatures to life. There are rumors that the book also brought the mysterious virus out as well, so that book has also turned the living into flesh-eating zombies. So if we find that book somewhere, there is a chance that we could break the spell, Vorn answered. By breaking the spell, it will kill the cat creatures and turn the world back to normal, meaning that the zombies are humans again. That sounds like a great idea. I know it's a crazy one, but I'm sure that will do us good, Daphne said. I could tell the gang about it. We can also explain it to Dog about it as well. I heard you two were talking about a book you mentioned. Steve did say something about that information you're saying is true, Vorn. We'll have a meeting tonight about it, and we'll have to find that book. It will be either in Max or Laura's possessions, Velma stated. Either who the book is with, we'll have to snatch it away somehow. Dusk piped in. Then a statement. There's a car, and it says South Station Scorpion Ridge on it. Velma pointed out a car with the words that she read, and it was a car that was a few feet from them. Let's check the car out. There might be some stuff inside to loot, Dusk said, as the girls headed for the car. Once they approached the car, they looked inside to see anyone around. No one's here, so maybe Steve and Max and Laura must have abandoned the car, Daphne said, as she opened the hood of the car. The car has been scrapped clean up of parts, so we don't have to worry about the car making sounds or alert the horde. That's good news. Hey, I see a book at the back seat, Thorn said, as she saw how smashed up the window of the back cars were, so she had no problem opening the car doors from the inside. What kind of book is this? Dusk asked. It says, The Frontier of the Dead. This is a spell book that Steve was talking about earlier. Thorn replied. She then reached inside the car to grab the book. Upon getting the book, however, she found a sniper rifle in the back of the seat of the car. She grabbed it from both items and then handed the book to Dusk. This book could help us kill the cat creatures off and help us turn the zombies back into humans and the world will go back to normal, Dusk said. The sniper rifle can help us too. We better get back into Dog Stockade and show everyone this book. This book could help us. But one thing I wonder is why Laura, Max, and Steve would just abandon it, Thorn wondered. Then the girls saw a mutated zombie with two heads about 2 feet away from them. That's a siren, girls. Dogs did about who they are, Dusk said. Thorn then positioned the sniper rifle. Then she looked through the scope. Are you great at sniping? Velma asked. In video games, yes, but not really here, Thorn replied. She took a deep breath as she fired 2 shots at the siren's 2 heads. They dropped dead upon getting shot, which didn't alert any zombies upon the noise. That's a nice shot you made, Daphne said to Thorn. Thanks, I kinda knew I could do it. Let's head home with the book and show everyone, Thorn replied. The girls all left the car and headed back to Dog Stockade. When they got to the front entrance of Dog Stockade, they heard a scream from one of the nurses inside the stockade.